So it's been a full year since I installed these solar panels and a large home battery on my new house. And I've got some news. They say solar power can save you thousands on energy bills. But what actually happened? This past year was a bit of a roller coaster ride, from the challenges of getting them installed to seeing how well they handled powering my all-electric house through heat waves, freezing temperatures, and a couple of small power outages. And spoiler alert, solar isn't all sunshine and rainbows. Was my net zero house ready for all of it? Was I able to achieve net zero energy? And most important, was it worth it? Let's just say I learned some pretty surprising lessons that may be of use to some of you. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Surfshark. So this is the second part to my what I learned after 1 year in my net zero house video. Now, the first part focused heavily on what went into my choices on constructing a factory-built, energy-efficient home with geothermal heating and cooling, a heat pump water heater, and more. I'll link to that one in the description if you want to see more after watching this one. My goal is to give you some strategies to keep in mind and possibly try. It's not that you should do exactly what I did, because you shouldn't. Everybody's circumstances are unique. But hopefully these videos spark some ideas in case you're interested in making your own home more energy efficient. And of course, I'll do my best to answer the lingering question, was all of this effort really worth it in the end? And a hint on that, we produced more energy over the course of a year than we actually used, so we comfortably achieved net zero. However, there is a little bit of a gotcha I discovered on how that works out financially and with my utility. But first, what do we install? We went with 43 REC alpha 400 watt panels, giving us a 17.2 kilowatt system. Now, most panels face south, while a few on the front face west to capture late afternoon and evening sun. Now, this setup is estimated to produce almost 18,000 kilowatt hours per year, or 18 megawatts. Now, we paired the panels with 20 kilowatt hours of Enphase IQ 5P batteries, which is not quite enough for 24 hour use at full power, but plenty to keep things current in an emergency for essential needs like the fridge and the HVAC system. There's a whole backstory on why we went with 20 kilowatt hours instead of 25 to 30, which is what I actually wanted, but I cover that in another video. And the price? Let's just say it wasn't cheap. The solar panels were $55,384, and the batteries were $33,407, for a grand total of $88,791. I break down all the pricing details in previous videos, which I'll link to in the description as well, along with one on the general costs of solar. I'll get into the final out-of-pocket costs later. To optimize and monitor energy use, we installed a couple of span smart panels for circuit-by-circuit usage data. Home Assistant powers the home automation setup with a dashboard that combines data from span, Enphase, and Finn for water tracking. It's a great way to monitor and automate our energy use. We've also installed Lutron Diva dimmers and switches, along with motion sensors to automatically turn off lights when rooms are empty, and to set up custom lighting scenes. Now, the Lutron Serena shades are programmed to adjust based on time of day and incoming sunlight, helping to control the indoor temperature even when we're not at home. And yes, the Lutron system gets high spouse approval and cat approval too. And before diving into the crazy high costs, it's important to consider a key point. Deciding on solar or any tech requires clarity on your specific goals. Solar isn't a one-size-fits-all solution. Some might say it's a scam that never pays off, while others claim that everyone should have it. But neither extreme is true. It's a highly individualized decision that depends on your unique situation. Try to ignore those extreme voices. In our case, we built this house as our forever home, so we made choices with a 30-year timeline in mind. That's why we invested in a super energy-efficient house design. It's a decision we believe will pay off financially and enhance our quality of life over time. We also built a single-story layout, not just for aesthetics, but for long-term accessibility, so we can age in place without worrying about stairs. And we wanted to keep monthly operational costs steady, regardless of future energy prices or inflation. Achieving net zero energy production was key to ensuring stability and energy independence, especially in emergencies like storms. I see my house as a whole system, not just the solar panels and battery, but how they interact with the home's energy efficiency, the geothermal HVAC, hot water production, and the EV charging. Everything is interconnected. So how was the performance over the first 12 months of solar? Before getting into that, I'll be on a trip in Germany by the time this video is out, where I'll be using today's sponsor, Surfshark. I've been using Surfshark for what feels like forever and get so much use out of it. Surfshark is a fast, easy-to-use VPN full of incredible features that you can install on an unlimited number of devices with one account. But that's not all. Even shopping services will sometimes gate prices on your location, so you can change your location to make sure you're getting the best deal. They also have add-ons to their VPN service to unlock things like Surfshark Alert, which will let you know if your email or personal details like passwords have been leaked in an online data breach. Right now, they're running an absolutely incredible holiday deal. For a limited time only, go to surfshark.com/undecided for 4 extra months of Surfshark at an unbeatable price. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. I've been using Surfshark for years, and I love it. Don't miss out on this great deal. The link's in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. So how did solar perform in the first 12 months? Well, my system produced 18.1 megawatt hours, right in line with the estimates for my installer and my own pre-install calculations. And for those of you considering professional installation, I cover my approach in detail in my Achieve Energy Independence course, which you can find on my website. If you're a do-it-yourselfer when it comes to solar, this guide is not really for you, but if you're considering hiring an installer like I did, it can be a huge help. I'll put a link in the description if you're interested. Now, according to my Span smart panel, my house used around 15.8 megawatt hours, but Enphase logged it closer to 16 megawatt hours. So we easily met our net zero energy goal with room to spare. Month by month, I was extremely surprised by winter performance, especially in November and February, which generated far more than I expected. November fell just a little bit shy of our energy use, and February even produced a surplus. The way this works out financially is also interesting, but I'll get into that in a bit. First, as I mentioned before, it's important to look at how everything performed to really understand if the costs were worth it. For now, we need to look at how solar paired with our performance of the geothermal system and hot water production, two of the biggest energy consumers in most homes. In previous videos, I shared that I spent $78,000 on our geothermal HVAC system, which includes hot water. The bulk of this cost came from drilling the geothermal well. It's a well that goes deep into the budget. Now, thanks to a 30% federal tax credit for geothermal, our effective cost drops to $54,600, which is more comparable but still more expensive than an air source heat pump that we considered at $38,000. If I'd retrofitted an older home, I could have received a $15,000 Massachusetts rebate for switching from natural gas to geothermal. In my case, though, as a new house, the geothermal system still played a role in an energy-efficient new build program. Now, this wasn't just for geothermal, but also for the air tightness and insulation levels of the whole home. Now, that rebate also worked out to $15,000. Now, taking that into account, it makes the effective cost of my geothermal system $39,600, which isn't that far off from that air source heat pump system. And even without the state rebate, the difference between the systems is $16,600. Over the year, our geothermal used around 2,260 kilowatt hours, or about $58.39 per month at 31 cents per kilowatt hour, totaling about $700.69 per year if I didn't have solar. Since our geothermal system includes a de-superheater, it preheats our water, reducing the load on our heat pump water heater. The water heater itself used about 818 kilowatt hours for the year, or roughly $21.14 a month, totaling $253.68 annually at local rates. And because I'm a super nerd and I love data, I collected historical electricity rate data for Massachusetts going back 34 years and calculated the average rate it increases each year. It's about a 3.28% increase on average. If you plot that out over the next 30 years, you find some interesting trends for everything in my house. I compared my geothermal heat pump water heater combo to a standalone heat pump water heater. My current hot water heater cost is about $253.68 per year, which I expect to rise to about $339.18 in 10 years. Over a decade, my geothermal setup will save about $2,639.87 compared to a standalone heat pump water heater, or $4,545 compared to a standard electric heater. That's just nuts. Now, my HVAC and hot water system combined currently costs about $954.37 per year to run, while the air source system with hot water that we considered would have cost about $2,121 per year. Without that $15,000 state rebate, the return on investment between the two systems would break even in about 11 years. But from year 12 to 25, which is a reasonable lifespan for the system, the geothermal system could save us an impressive $27,000. If you do start off counting that $15,000 state rebate, the two systems are essentially the same cost right from the start. By year 25, my geothermal system will be about $42,000 ahead of the air source system. Of course, these electricity costs are theoretical for me since I'm net positive with solar. Essentially, by installing solar, I've prepaid for electricity over the next 30 years, fixing my costs and protecting against future rate hikes. So my return on investment really hinges on the solar system cost. I'm taking advantage of the 30% federal tax credit and a $1,000 Massachusetts credit for solar and battery installs, which lowers the effective cost to $61,153. Plus the Massachusetts Smart Program, which is a renewable energy credit system based on the grid contributions, should provide around $5,000 over 10 years, bringing my cost down to about $56,153. I'm also enrolled in my Utilities Connected Solutions program, which uses my battery to help stabilize the grid during summer peak loads. They pay $275 per average kilowatt used during the summer. Last summer, I participated in 44 events, averaging 6.84 kilowatts, which earned me about $1,881. Unlike Tesla, which takes a 20% cut, most participating battery companies like Enphase, Sonnen, Franklin, Fortress, Panasonic, and Solark, basically everybody else, pass on the full amount to customers. Over the program's five-year span, this could bring in around $9,400, reducing my effective solar and battery cost to about $46,000. Without solar, my annual electricity cost would have been about $4,800. Now, this means my system will break even in about 9 years, and from year 10 to 30, it should save us around $196,000. Because installing solar is like bulk buying your electricity for the next 30 years, I was curious what the per kilowatt hour price would be if we broke it up over time, or basically just what's the per unit electricity price. My REC panels have a 25-year warranty, but will last well beyond that. The warranty is for at least 98% of output in year 1 and 92% in year 25. That means a 0.25% degradation rate. Even with a 0.25% yearly degradation, my panels should still produce around 16.8 megawatt hours annually by year 30, down from 18.1 megawatt hours this year. This matches my payback timeline around year 9, when my solar panel cost per kilowatt hour dips below today's electricity prices. Given likely rate increases, utility electricity could cost around 37 to 38 cents per kilowatt hour by that point. And by year 20, my solar cost drops to 13 cents per kilowatt hour, and by year 30, it's 9 cents per kilowatt hour. With potential utility rates at 76 cents per kilowatt hour by year 30, the long-term savings are clear. But remember that these calculations are unique to my setup. You can't take them and apply it to your situation, since the size, makeup, and cost of the system will be very different for you. Installation costs vary a lot. But here's the catch. We still have an electric bill. We still have a $10 monthly minimum charge for our grid connection, which seems fair to me to help maintain the local grid. But here's the important detail. In Massachusetts, for every kilowatt hour I send to the grid, I get a one-to-one net metering credit. Sort of. On your bill, you pay a supply fee and a generation fee. I mentioned I pay 31 cents per kilowatt hour here. Now, if you broke that price up, it would look something like 15 cents for supply and 16 cents for delivery. It's not that literally, but just for illustration. That one-to-one credit is like wiping out both, up until you go net positive for the month. At that point, I get credited for supply cost only, which amounts to earning a credit of around 12 to 18 cents per kilowatt hour. So right now, I have over $500 in credits in my account, which will help to cover December and January bills when solar production drops significantly. Last year, our bill for those 2 months was around $752. So these credits should cover most of that. Now, realistically, we might only pay around $200 to $300 every year, which I'm very happy with. And this limited credit for net positive generation also makes the battery more financially valuable, since storing and using our solar energy locally is the better option. That's why I'm excited Span rolled out the Charge on Solar feature for their EV charger, the Span Drive. I used to do this with a kind of a hack in Home Assistant, but now it's seamless. I can charge my EV when there's only excess solar, keeping as much of my generation local as possible. So was this whole endeavor, solar, battery, geothermal, heat pump water heater, heat pump dryer, and everything else I did worth it? Well, to find out, I compared our house's costs and energy use to a similar theoretical standard efficiency home with an air source heat pump. I tried to do an apples to apples here by basing it off of my current house. Now, before we had the solar and home battery installed, our house had achieved a HERS rating of 32. That's a rating of how efficient your house is. A net zero home would hit, well, zero, which I think our house is actually hitting right now. At the time we built this house, the local requirements were for at least achieving a HERS rating of 52. As of July this year, new houses require a HERS rating of 42 to pass. So keeping the solar and home battery out of this for the moment, yearly cost to run a comparable home, the HERS 52 house with air source heat pump would cost about $10,400 a year to run. A Hertz 42 house with air source heat pump would have cost about $8,400 to run. A Hertz 32 house with air source heat pump would cost about $6,400 to run. My home with Geo is about $4,800. Over 30 years, the Hertz 32 home saves over $215,000 compared to the Hertz 52 home, and about $100,000 compared to the Hertz 42 home. My home, without solar or battery, would save nearly $300,000 versus the Hertz 52 home and close to $200,000 over the Hertz 42 home. So at the end of all of this, my wife and I do think it was worth it in the end. It's been an electrifying experience. The house has achieved our goals of saving money over time, reducing dependence on the grid and fossil fuels, all while giving us the comfort that we were looking for in our forever home. Your mileage will vary, or rather your kilowattage will vary. And on that note, you should check out Energysage for great articles and reviews on solar and heat pump HVAC equipment. I found them to be an amazing resource when researching for both my previous house and for this one. For US residents, my Energysage portal connects you with local installers and provides quotes for solar and heat pumps without sharing your phone number. You won't get deluged with random calls. It's also an affiliate program, so I do earn a small commission, but regardless, I find Energysage a great way to easily compare installers side by side. I highly recommend it. But what do you think? Have you done anything like this on your home, or are you considering specific elements? Jump into the comments and let me know. And be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, while we'll keep this conversation going. And thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support. Keep your mind open, stay curious, and I'll see you in the next one.